First thing that we will need to talk about is why did we decide to create a new program? Probably most of you don't know MITACS, and I will talk a bit about MITACS in the next slide. But the overall idea of this program is to give undergraduate students additional opportunities in Canada should they wish to do research internships in a Canadian university. Currently, Fulbright Canada already offers a program for undergraduate students, which probably some of you may know. It's the KILLM program. However, this is a bit different because we are partnering with an organization that is dedicated to advancing research and internships, which provide us a more leverage in terms of the possibilities in the opportunities that students have access to. And that's why the Globalink program came about, to provide US students with more opportunities at Canadian universities that they would otherwise not have. MITACS, some of you might not have heard about MITACS until now. It's a Canadian not-for-profit organization that has been around for 20 years. Since the beginning, they have dedicated their work into expanding possibilities for research and providing scholarships, both for academic settings and also for industry. However, for the Globalink program that we will be talking about, we are focusing mostly on the academic side of things, at least for this first edition. Because the program was just recently launched, so we launched it early October, we are trying to keep this first edition as simple as possible, and we are not engaging with MITACS in its full potential. So there are other variants that we can explore with them, but for the time being, we are just looking at the undergraduate internships possibilities. This program, the Globalink, was launched by MITACS. So MITACS has their own Globalink program, and it was created in 2003. Since then, they have expanded the program to several partner countries, and the US was one of the main countries that they wanted to reach, and they decided that it would be a great idea to join forces with Fulbright Canada and approach the US market with under a common partnership. So let's talk about the program and its specifics so that we are all on the same page when we talk about the in more detail in the next slides. So this is a program that it's meant for US students to come to Canada to undertake research projects. Projects are available in a multitude of areas of knowledge. Students are expected to spend between 10 to 12 weeks in Canada between May and October. So we understand that depending on the university in the US, the summer break is different. Therefore, we are able to adjust the time for students between 10 to 12 weeks and any time between May and October. Students will be placed at a Canadian university and undertake a supervised research project. They will be given the opportunity to also take part in other activities, and they may interact with companies of interest through tours or individual meetings. This is something that it's still to be defined how we would go about it, but it's a possibility. Also, they will have extensive opportunity for cultural, social, and recreational experiences while in Canada. So this is basically the program in a nutshell. Now let's go into more specific elements. Like I mentioned in the previous slide, the program is open to all fields of knowledge. Some of you were asking if the student would need to indicate in this first stage which university or professor they would like to work with. And the answer is no, that is not something that is supposed to take place at this first stage. And by this first stage, I mean the application until October 31st. But we will talk more about that. However, because this is a program that it's open to all fields, students should not be overly concerned about if their field will be represented, because as you will see, there are several hundred opportunities inside this program. The eligibility for this program is pretty straightforward, but it's important that everyone is aware of them. So the student needs to be an undergraduate student studying at an accredited university located in US territory. So please note that even if the university is a US university, but with a campus elsewhere, if the student is taking a full-time and a full degree in that campus, they will not be able to apply for this program. So they need to be located in US territory. They need to be US citizens, all the valid US passport, and they can also be Canadian citizens. So it's not a problem. They need to have at least one semester remaining in their program of studies as of fall 2020. As an overall guideline, we would say that the ideal candidate would be a candidate that it's applying while he is in his third year. So this is just a general sort of guideline. However, if they expect to receive an undergraduate degree in spring 2021 or beyond, and if they are, for example, in their fourth year, that's fine. The only thing that cannot happen is either first year students are not encouraged to apply. That's too early. Second year, probably if they are reaching the end of their program of their second year. Ideally, third year, and if possible, fourth year also, if they still have program left in the spring of 2021. So hopefully this provides a bit of a guideline as to which students are the most indicated for the program. We do not define any specific GPA. However, because this is a competition, the higher and the most competitive, the better. They will need to be able to spend 10 to 12 weeks in Canada between May and October. And these are consecutive weeks. They are not supposed to go back and forth during the period that they are doing their internship. They need to be proficient in English. And should they want to go into a French-speaking environment, like university or a research center that uses French as their main language, they also need to be proficient in French. And there is a specific form that I will show you that will provide some guidance as to how can they demonstrate proficiency. Because this is a program that was launched with a very short deadline, the applications are open until the end of this month. So we are basically, from the moment that we start advertising until the end, it's roughly a month. So that's not the best scenario, but hopefully we are able to attract competitive applications. The benefits of this program, because this is a Fulbright Canada program, even if you take this program, you don't have any limitation to apply to the traditional student, to the Fulbright traditional student awards. So you can apply to those awards without the need to sort of wait the mandatory 2 years. You will have access to Canada's top research facilities. This will provide students with a valuable international experience. And because Canada and the US have so many similarities in terms of culture, it will be easy to adjust to coming to Canada. It will provide them, because they are coming during the summer months, it's not critical the question of the Canadian winter. So it's a very easy experience to translate from the US context to the Canadian one. It's a rewarding experience that combines not only academic elements, but also professional skills and personal growth. And they will be entitled to a grant of 7,800 Canadian dollars for the period of time from the 10 or the 12 weeks that they will be here. The pieces of information or documentation that they need to provide are a complete application form, their transcript up to the time that they are applying, a current CV, two references provided via a specific form, and a personal statement. We have noticed that in one of our previous reference forms, there was wording related to providing the reference in a sealed envelope. That's not the case. The reference just need to send us the form directly on an email, and that's it. There's no need for extra paper copies or anything like that. Well, we will talk more about the documents, but now talking a bit about the review. As you will see in a couple of slides, the MITACS program is, so the program that they have initially is pretty competitive in terms of the number of applicants that they receive. We expect that the application from the US will follow the same trend. Once again, because this is the first time that the program is being promoted, we are unsure of what will be the final number of applications, but we are definitely looking at having strong applicants, similar to what we find in the Kilim program. Students will be evaluated in a combination of aspects that include their academic records, personal statement, their skills and interests, and why they want to apply for this program, and the letters of recommendation. So we try to look at the overall picture when we assess the candidates, and not just the academic elements per se. The timeline that we anticipate, and once again, this might be, we might need to adjust based on information or elements that we were not expecting. So until October the 31st, we are receiving the applications. And once again, these applications do not need to mention anything related to the universities of preference or faculty members that the students want to explore. What we are looking at this point is the profile of the candidates and how suitable they seem to be for this program. That's the main scope of this first stage. We anticipate that by January next year, we have been able to select the recommended candidates, and then in that time, by the end of the month, the candidates are able to then be contacted and asked to select from a list of available projects which are the ones that they would like to explore. Because this program is new, and there is not we don't yet have an exact definition of how this will be done, but we anticipate that it will be in a way that it will allow the candidates to have as many options as possible in terms of the choices that they can make, so the ranking. But we will need to see that also based on the number of applications that we receive. By February 2020, candidates are invited to submit the Globalink application, meaning that they will be submitting their ranked options. By March 2020, a committee reviews the application and confirms which projects are going to go forward and receive the grant. Talking about the Globalink research internship program in general, this is information that provides you a bit of a context as to how big the program is. So these numbers are each year. So 1,100 of senior undergraduate students around the world work with Canadian researchers on matched projects. So this is how many students are placed every year, 1,100. They receive for the program that they run in other countries 17,000 applications and to 2,500 research projects. So this is a program that it's very big in Canada. And we expect to be able to provide all these opportunities also to U.S. candidates. Just for the sake of for extra information, the MITACS Globalink program is especially strong in countries such as Brazil, Mexico, when there are a lot of candidates that apply for this program every year. So the matching process, and once again, this is something that it's the general idea. We might need to do adjustments, but the program usually reaches out to professors in 67 Canadian universities that submit project proposals. The students are invited to submit applications and sort of see which from the proposals, which are the ones that are more attractive to them. Both the professors and the students are then, we put them in touch so that they can discuss the right fit for them. And because this program allows access to all of the major universities in Canada, it's very likely that students will always find something that it's of interest to them. So talking more about the pieces of information that students need to provide in this first stage, the personal statement. In the personal statement, we would like to highlight these five aspects that they need to take into consideration. So the candidates should discuss what they hope to accomplish during their stay in Canada, how this experience fits with their current interests and future goals, highlighting any experience that demonstrates their ability to adapt to new cultures, their willingness to share and learn from people from other countries, and their abilities to act as ambassadors for the United States. So as you can see, there is a lot of room for students to talk about, for example, volunteering work or work that they have in associations or something that goes beyond the academic aspect of what they currently do. So it's very good to tap into all of those aspects for so that the candidates can really shine and show all of their value in terms of how can they bring added value to a Canadian university. Their CV is supposed to be no more than 3 pages, which I assume it's not difficult for an undergraduate student to not go beyond 3 pages. And they should provide detail in aspects related to their education, eventually some work experience, volunteering, scholarships, and awards that they might have received, achievement, interests, and language. So things that relate to sports achievements or anything that has to do with the community, that is highly valued by our reviewers. So make sure that they don't miss any of those elements. The references. They need to provide 2 references. At least one needs to be from a professor that is familiar with the student's work. And the professor should ideally be from the university, not a high school professor. That's why we don't encourage applications from first-year students, because they haven't yet established a rapport with professors. So by the third year, they should be able to be in shape for this, or even during like late second year. Provide the references. The references are supposed to send the forms directly to us. So they are supposed to send it by email for the email that it's mentioned there, no later than the November 15. Okay, so there is a bit of a leeway after the deadline has closed. Reference letters can be added for further information if they wish to do so, and no need for references to be provided on paper. So everyone or everything is done online. So before going into the questions, I will just like to share with you what you can see in the Fulbright website. So if a candidate is interested in applying, or if you are assisting any candidate in the application process, you should go to fulbright.ca. Under programs, go to undergraduate students. Globalink program will show up in the menu. When you click it, you are directed to the page that has the information about the program and the main aspects that you need to keep in mind. You need to come to application instructions, and in here you have some forms, but you don't need to download them from here, because I'll show you where you will download them. This is basically, this just provides you a step-by-step reference of what you need to do in order to apply. So you need to complete a form, an application form, a personal statement of one page, a clear and concise CV, 3 pages maximum. So someone was asking if it's single or double. It doesn't make a difference. So if by double it would go beyond 3 pages, use single. The contact for 2 references, and also make sure that the student reaches out to the references and asks them to fill out the reference form and send it to this email. The reference form in the form itself, it says this, but just to double check, make sure that the student knows that he needs to do that. An official university transcript scanned. Okay, we don't need to receive paper. We just want digital copies at this point. And should you be interested in a French-speaking institution, also provide language proficiency. Just this the report that you see here. So this is basically someone that is able to assess your French at your home university, and they can fill out this document. So if you are ready to apply, then you come to apply now. You fill all this information. Once again, the forms are here again, and you upload them here. So application form, personal statement, CV, transcript, French language. All of those things are uploaded here. Once again, the confidential reference form is sent to us directly. So everything is listed, is defined here in the notes. As a way to sort of just assist us with managing the emails that we receive, we need the student to mention which references they have requested, so the identification, so that we can then cross this information with any emails that we receive. Everything is ready. Tick the boxes and submit, and you're ready to go. So at this point now, I can answer some of the questions that you may ask during the time that I was speaking. So just to confirm, if you have joined later in the presentation, I will be providing the recording of this presentation to everyone that registered. So don't worry, you will have access to these materials. So let me go back and see the questions. Just to be clear, can second year students apply, so sophomore and juniors? So like I mentioned, the ideal candidate would be a candidate that it's around the third year. Okay, and we are talking about four-year degrees or even five. However, if there is a second year student that is really promising and is really a student that stands out, if he's able to get good references, then there is no point in not accepting an application from a student like that. So I guess it all depends on how promising that candidate is. However, first year, it's definitely not something that we would be looking at. Navis is asking if our office will be proposing 3 to 7 possible projects to the candidates. That is what we anticipate. However, I will not confirm that it's up to a maximum of 7, because we still need to define which is the best way to address the second stage. And once again, it's based on the number of applications that we receive, that we will need to basically sit down with MITACS and see which is the best way forward. But they will definitely have several options to choose from. As Kathleen is asking, if a candidate is selected in January and asked to rank projects, does that guarantee them a space on some projects, or can they still be cut from the competition at that time? So what we anticipate is that once they are recommended, as long as they find projects that are suitable to them, they should be in a good shape to receive the award. Once again, we need to see how many applicants we receive. And if we receive a large number, we might need to do a second triage in the second stage. But that's something that we will still need to confirm. So those advanced engineers are the ones who will participate. Okay, this is the same question, if there is good research internship. So the answer is the same. Is we anticipate that the ones that are recommended would be in very good shape to receive the scholarship. But once again, we anticipate that we might be able to provide around 25 in this first edition. So that's something that we will then need to sort of confirm depending on the number of applications and strong applicants that we receive. So someone was asking about the CV, it's single page or double space. Once again, I would say that for an undergraduate student to have more than 3 pages CV, it's probably not very common. So a single space would definitely be the option. If by any chance using double space, it would go beyond 3 pages. But we anticipate that people are able to basically summarize the information in a way that doesn't go beyond 3 pages. So Margaret is asking, can you give example of types of projects being ghosted? What I will do is the following. In the email that I will send you, I will provide a link that is available in the from information that it's available in the MITACS website that addresses the projects that were developed in previous years. Because there are so many, I might as well just provide you the link and you can browse at your own time and take the time you need to look into that. And that will give you a very good overview of what has been done so far. So someone said, ask the RIA positions available. So like I mentioned, we anticipate around 25. Would the grant cover costs like housing, travel, and food, or just for research-related costs? So the purpose of the grant is to cover living costs. So we anticipate that if the student comes to Canada with that grant, they should not have any extra out-of-the-pocket expenses unless they live a very lavish lifestyle, but they should be fine with that money in Canada. What expense would applicants need to pay out of pocket? So we anticipate that most things will be paid through the grant. So let me see. So how Canadian students are solicited? Are these faculty already working with Fulbright Canada? So because we partner with MITACS and they already have a network of professors that are fully familiar with the process, we rely on them to handle that part of the project. So the network that MITACS has is the one that we are relying for reaching out to the professors and to explore the projects. Just see the reason. Should students make a strong case for why Canada? Well, they definitely should make a strong case to why come to Canada to do an internship. We are not expecting to read essays about why Canada, why they are choosing Canada, because we understand that obviously if they want to come here, they already see value in coming to Canada, but more why they would like to explore an academic experience at the Canadian university. That's probably more where we are aiming at. If grantees are provided with housing, I don't think they are providing with housing right from the start, meaning that I don't think we will be seeking housing for them. But because during that time of the year, there are usually university residences available because it's vacation time, I would say that most of them would be able to get residencies at the university. How much should they talk about previous research experience in the personal statement? If the projects are advanced, this may be important. Definitely, that would be a very good thing to talk about. So if they have been in contact with research projects before, if they have been in laboratories or doing field research, things like that, definitely that is something that they should highlight, because the professors in Canada will be looking at students that are either promising students in terms of academics or in terms of their research experience. And anything that the student can say that basically provides extra insight into those topics will be welcome. How long should the personal statement be? That's a good question. I don't know if we are talking about one page project statement. Let me just see if there is any indication as to that in the instructions. Yes, personal statement of one single space page maximum. Yes. So one single space page maximum. Where will students live? So like I mentioned, students can probably live in most cases in the university residences if they are available. However, because the funding is being provided, they can choose wherever they wish to live, as long as they are comfortable living in for example, apartments with other students. So far, I think I answered most of the questions that I had that I can see. I know that someone is typing. Will the student pick the 12-week period for the research, or will the organization hosting the project? Will the student pick the 12-week period for the research, or will the organization hosting the project? I'm not entirely sure what you mean with this question, Paul. When the student is being matched, you will need to specify if he's interested in the 10 or the 12-week, based on the calendar of their own institution. That's something that that will be addressed at that time. Will students receive their funding in time to purchase flights? I'm not able to answer that at this point, Marian. We anticipate that probably in some cases that may not be possible. But we will need to see. It's not a question that I'm able to answer at this time. So the grant is meant to cover the cost of the housing. Will there be aid to help students find housing within the university? And there's an estimator of how much it will cost. My answer is the same. So we anticipate that there will be residences in universities. We will need to see on an individual case. I'm not aware of how much is the residency of each house, of each university. However, if they choose, for example, to rent a room in an apartment of students, it should be around $300-$400 Canadian dollars a month. So it's not critical. If it's in a residence, it will be more, probably more north of, I don't know, $600. But all of those things would even if we don't provide housing for everyone on a way that we are guaranteeing everyone to find a housing for them, because that's not possible, they will definitely have some assistance from their home university, from the host university. So Knives is mentioning the application form under language says secondary school. I assume it means high school, correct? Yes. Is there a limit on how many students can be selected from its institution in the US? No, Marion, we haven't specified any limits on that regards. So it's basically what we are looking is the profile of the students, not so much where they come from. Will the student be at a disadvantage if they do not know French? No, only if they want to go to a French-speaking university. But if that's not the case, the French is not required. So we understand that if a student goes into an English-speaking setting, there's no need to know French. So someone is typing. I'm assuming it's another question. So the overall idea that I wish to leave is the following: because this is the first time that the project is being that this program is running, there are a lot of things that we don't yet have the answer to. However, both Fulbright Canada and MITACS have extensive experience in dealing with undergraduate students, so we don't anticipate that there will be any major issues during this first leg of this program. However, some of the questions we will only be able to answer them later in the process. So at this time, I think I've answered all the questions that were made. Most of you probably have reached out to me by mail. If you have by email, if you haven't, you can reach out to me by globalink@fulbright.ca, and you can ask me any questions that you may have from now onwards, and we will try to tackle things as they show up. In terms of the applications, because we are already past halfway October, we encourage everyone that is either assisting students or if you are a student that wants to apply, to really get your application going. The major piece is probably your project statement. That's where you will need to put a bit more thought into it. The application form is pretty straightforward. The reference is pretty straightforward, and the references can submit it after October 31st, so they have an extra 2 weeks. So get some